shaded a little bit.
Oh.
A little dim, but it'll work. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for having me in lovely Ohio again.
OH!
That's right. I do really appreciate coming here. So this is a great group. You're probably one of the best PACs that I deal with in our region. So my hat off to you, because you guys do great work. You keep everyone informed.
Oh, you tell all the PACs that, man.
I don't. And the worst one is my own, is Michigan. They might meet once a year. So you really do a good job. And so I really enjoy coming here. I was asked to do a couple things today. One is to talk about Appendix G. Another is talk about the four-year process and how you move into that four-year process. And then I want to talk a little bit about the conference schedule coming up so that I remind you what's going on next year, because things are going to get shuffled around. And also to show you what's going to happen with people who are going to have initial on-sites during that time period. All right, Appendix G. How many attended the webinar that Craig Hartley had on Appendix G? Quite a few. And I know you've got the link on your website now to go and watch that, and I encourage you to still do that, even though I'm going to go, over some of the same information. But the first thing I need to do is give you a little caveat here. Don't shoot the messenger. If you remember, I warned you, I think the last meeting I attended, that this was coming. Maybe two meetings ago, that this was coming down the pipe. And I'll explain kind of how that happened, as well as what is going to happen for the future, okay? So if you want, if you can't find it on your website, I do have some links here as to how to get to it through Power DMS. Power DMS did put it on their help screen as well. So if you go to their help screen and you type in under what can we help you today, you type in Appendix G, it'll pop up in this little box here down the bottom that Laura Saunders put in for us. And it's a long website, but here's what the actual site is. But it's probably easiest if you go to the SOAR website and find it that way. Just click on there and go to it. It was about an hour long, if I remember right. But it was pretty basic, in my opinion. But it was good. The boss did a good job as far as describing what the issue was and how we're going to move forward in the future. But I think, in my head, I need some more historical context for me. And so I'm going to present that to you, because I'm thinking if that's the way my brain works, hopefully, or I think some of you work the same way. As a former accreditation manager myself, I kind of wanted to know where we were and why we're changing now. Okay, so let me give you a little flashback. Maybe Ray will remember this stuff. I don't know if the rest of you will.
We can just call him OG from
there. You go. He and I are together in this, probably. All right. How many worked with paper files before? Before case. Wow. Okay, there's a couple of us. Woo! All right, paper files, the way it used to be done before case came out, it was totally paper. You had to typewrite the individual standard status report. And if it wasn't other than the mandatory standard, you had to type it on yellow or tan paper. I mean, it was so specific, you needed to do that kind of stuff. Later on, we come out with the case program and it kind of modernized some of that, some of those features, and so it was a little easier to work with. But you still had to type or print everything out on tan paper. Back in those days, and I'm talking 80s and early 90s, you needed to have 3 proofs of compliance for each standard, each bullet for each year. So if you had a 3 bulleted standard, you would have to have 9 proofs of compliance in the bottom, right? Because it was one for each bullet each year. There were various methods of highlighting that were acceptable. CLIA tells you what you need to do, not how to do it. So we didn't specify which one of these methods were appropriate. But let me show you how some of that worked. There was bracketing, flagging, and color highlighting. For bracketing, pretty simple. I mean, you had you have a document and you bracket along the side and indicate what bullet or what standard that section applied to that you're trying to show the assessor. And this worked really well because it was easy for the accreditation manager to go through a document, bracket it, and move on to the next standard. And it worked well for multiple highlights or multiple bullets as well, because you could just go down the line and bracket them all out. But for the assessor, when you've got the stuff that looked like this, where the bullets are out of alphabetical order, and maybe even on multiple pages of a 10-page document, for example, it got very confusing for an assessor to try to find the information they're looking for. So we're flipping back and forth between pages, because assessors are taught to start at the top of the standard and move down. You read the standard first, then you look at the directive, and you look at the proofs, and you go from A to Z. That's how we're taught to do it. So it got very confusing for them in time. It took a lot of time to go through that. There was also a flagging method. A lot of people did this, where you took those little post-it note flags, stuck it on the side of the page, kind of like bracketing. And that worked great too, because it was a nice highlight, different colors, drew your attention. But again, when you got multiple pages and multiple bullets that were out of order, it got a little bit crazy. Plus, the bullets came off in the files. They get stuck in there, and they pull off, and now you're really out of luck because you can't find where the section was you're looking for. Then we have the lovely colored highlighting method. How many did the rainbow highlight? Ooh, just a couple of us that remember this. With this method, what you did is you created a key at the beginning of the file. For example, A's, your A bullets are going to all do in yellow, B's in pink, C's in blue. Well, what happens after D, E, F, G, H, right? You did multiple colors. So you combined two of them. So the top part of the sentence you would do with yellow, the bottom you do with pink. And you had to keep that same color format throughout the whole, all your files. They had to stay the same. So it got, again, very confusing, even more so than the flagging method or the bracketing method, because now the assessors are going back and forth between a table with all the different colors you put on it. It was just a nightmare. It was a nightmare. So, in order to fix some of that, oh, here's an example. Here's an example how that would work. That's your ISSR on the top of the page, and you'd have your written directive all color-coded appropriately. Then you'd have all your proofs. So here's year one proofs. In this case, they were able to use one type of document for three different proofs for that year. Each bullet was on that document. In year two, they were not able to get bullet B in their number two proof, so they had to come up with another one. So they created another document here just to cover B, and they were able to do the same, all of them for bullet, or for document number four. Down here, this bullet they were not able to do on a single document. So you had nine different documents then for that one bullet, for the whole file. So what happens in that kind of a situation? The files were huge. They were very big. I think in my agency, I think we had a full cabinet, filing drawer cabinet, full of nothing but our files because they were so large. Our last on-site assessment before Power DMS, I think we had that down to two drawers. So it was pretty cumbersome to work with. So again, that process, what were the pros of all of that? The pros were you could use one copy of a document within the file and then put your different bullets wherever they were that they occurred on that document. And it was very easy for the accreditation manager to do that. But the drawbacks were that they created large files and they were very cumbersome for the assessor. And let's face it, we're trying to make the assessor's job easier because a happy assessor is a happy accreditation manager, right? So we want to make their job easier so we don't frustrate them in the process, and then that rubs off onto you in your assessment. So someone come up with a change. So we had a paradigm shift as to how we were going to do this now for the future. And again, it was not mandated. It was just, here's a recommendation on how to do this in the future. And so we had the bullet page method. How many did that? How many remember bullet pages? A few. With bullet pages, what you did is you created a page or one page of a document, a specific color maybe, it didn't matter, but a different color than what the rest of your documents were, be it blue, yellow, whatever, and it just said bullet A, bullet B. And then you put all of your documents behind that page so that they're easy to find for the assessor. And it kind of looked like this. So you'd have your ISSR, and the next page you'd hit would be a bullet page. And you would have the written directive first, and then your proofs of compliance behind it, as they related to bullet A. And then bullet B the same way, and bullet C the same way. So that was really easy for the assessor. Very easy. I loved it. But as the accreditation manager, I hated it, because now I had to make multiple pages of all those documents and highlight them all separately. So it created a lot of work for the accreditation manager, but it was very easy for the assessor to navigate through. So a lot of people did it that way. Then we had another paradigm shift. Why? Because of all the duplication that we were seeing. And all, you know, you had to make 15 copies of a report to put in one file. So somebody decided we should change again, and out come Appendix G. In the fifth edition, I looked back at the history on Appendix G, and it said it came out in December of 2009. I don't think that date's right. I thought it was earlier in 2000, like 2003 or 2004, somewhere in there. But what it was meant to do was to assist the accreditation manager with file construction. Here's how we recommend, here's how CALEA recommends you construct your files. It was to assist you in determining the best proofs of compliance to put in the file, provide guidance on how many proofs. That was the biggest issue. How many proofs of compliance to put in the file? And then to reduce the duplication of all the documentation that was within that file. So that was the original intent. So here's the beginning part of Appendix G, as it currently is in the fifth edition. This is not sixth, this is fifth edition. But it talks about what the proofs of compliance considerations are. The biggest things are to remember is that they have to be relevant proofs. That is one thing that I know I saw as an assessor, is you, even with the bullet page method, you go find a document and it had absolutely nothing to do with the bullet. It's like, what is this here for? I don't understand. Now, the accreditation manager thought it had something to do with it, and it made sense to them, but there were no notes on that page, so I could never figure it out. So make sure that if you have documents in there, that they are truly relevant to the bullet you're trying to prove. And if not, if it's only apparent to you, then put a note on it just to tell them why you think it's appropriate. You want to make sure that your information does not conflict with other standard statements or agency directives. And that's a given. But the biggest thing is the next one. Your proof or proofs need to show continued compliance throughout the 3-year period. And somehow we forgot this, or this was misinterpreted going down the road. We had this chart that came up, and this is in the middle of Appendix G, and this is specifically regarding time-sensitive standards. So how many documents should you have in the file for time-sensitive standards? And this chart come up with that. Well, that middle section, how many are required for a minimum for each year? This is my opinion. This is not a CALEA thing. This is my opinion. I think what happened is all of us, because I did it myself, we took that number and then applied it to non-time-sensitive standards arbitrarily. Because it's not meant for that, but that's what we did. We applied it to non-time-sensitive standards, and that became then the unwritten rule. You only need to prove one bullet for 1 year as you move through the standard. Does that make sense as to how that may have happened? Some of you understand this concept? Okay, I think that's what happened, that we kind of misinterpreted along the line. And when I say we, it was everybody. It was not just Kalia or the accreditation managers either. Kalia's staff misinterpreted that too, because we were training it later on, one bullet per year, that's all you had to show. So we fostered our own problem. When I brought this topic up during the development stage of this four-year process, we're sitting in a meeting with staff, and it didn't make sense to me. How is the compliance service member sitting five states away reviewing these documents on the web? How are they going to understand or verify compliance with the standard when only bullet A has been proven for bullet A, B, and C? How are they going to verify compliance? So that was my question. How are we going to do this? And the answer was, well, agencies have to prove all bullets. But no, they don't. There's one bullet per year. And so a bunch of us who got on that kind of bandwagon that have done this for a while said, no, one a year. And so then the boss pulled out this. No. It says right in Appendix G, because he helped write it, pulled out Appendix G, proofs provided by the agency must clearly support each bullet and show continued compliance with the three-year assessment period. What happened is the field and the assessor staff and the CALIA staff went down one road, the bosses all thought we're going down another. And that's really what kind of happened. There's an unwritten rule, and no one figured it out until this new process came up. And then we figured it out. So we said, how are we going to fix it? Well, the immediate response was, well, we're going to tell everybody that they have to provide proofs for each bullet for each year. And we said, whoa, you can't do that midstream. You can't change that fast, because we have caused this problem ourselves as staff members and assessors and everyone else. We caused this problem. We can't make the agencies do this. So we discussed bringing it to the commission to decide what we're going to do. I'm kind of out of order here. So what they decided to do was they were going to address it in the sixth edition and make changes to the Appendix G. And I'll talk more about that later. Here's what Craig Hartley helped write Appendix G. So he said this was the original intent of the document. The original intent was, if you had a similar document that you were using, let's say a CAD report, and you're using it to prove bullet A, bullet B, in this case, said, yeah, there's no reason to highlight bullet A and B for both years, because if it's the date, if you're trying to prove like bullet A is the date a call was received, and bullet B is the name of the caller. Once I see it in one document, I know where to find it in the second. I don't need you to highlight it for me. I know where it's at. I can find it because it's the same document, just a different year. So he said that was the original intent, was only to highlight one bullet for one year, but the information was still available on the proof, even though you didn't highlight it. He said if you did have documents, like down here for bullet C, you did have a bullet that you could not prove with one document for all the proofs, then you had to create a new document or provide a new document. So that's what this graphic kind of represents. If you had a similar document, you can do multiple bullets in that document, but if it was not a similar document, you'd have to provide that other proof of compliance. Does that make sense? That was the original intent. That intent was not put on paper, so none of us saw it, and we kind of went down our own road. There's another example of how that worked. Because this is what was really in practice then. We started doing just singular proofs and moving on, regardless if they're the same document or not. So, like I said, we misinterpreted Appendix G, and over the years we kind of had mission creep. and everyone decided, worked on the same page, and we were going to do that one bullet thing. And so it rests on all of us. I mean, it rests on employee staff, because we were training them wrong. We were. So after it was decided and talked about, the commission decided we're going to maintain status quo for now. So once we figure this all out, said, don't go anywhere. But that's at the point where I started telling you, something's going to change. You know, I'll give you a little heads up. Something's going to change. I don't know what, but something's going to change with this. And they said they're addressing the 6th edition. So what they did in the 6th edition, Appendix G, is it addresses the 4-year process, because Appendix G in the 5th talks about 3-year. And so rather than amending Appendix G 5.3, they just changed the 4-year process in 6.0. And then it's more clearly defined that you must show compliance with all bullets for each year in that document. You can use one proof for all bullets. You can still do what we've been doing. But you have to make sure it sufficiently satisfies each bullet in that document. If it does not, you'll need a different document or an interview or an observable to show compliance for that year. Okay, does that make sense? Okay. I've got some examples, and we'll talk about them here in a minute. The reason why they decided this wouldn't be too bad of a change was because of Power DMS. Because we're no longer requiring that the individual status standards report, because it's already built into Power DMS when you put your documents in. The table of contents for that file is already created. Power DMS allows us to do digital highlighting, so you can do multiple bullets very quickly on the document. But what's different than the color-coded method or the flagging or the other methods we did back in the 80s and 90s was that with Power DMS, the assessors can filter those bullets. And that's how they're being trained to do it now, is to use Power DMS's filtering option to click bullet A, and they see all documents then just for bullet A. They click on B, all documents just for bullet B. So there's a couple things that have to happen with that. One is you have to make sure as the accreditation manager that you link the bullet appropriately to the highlight for that to work. Okay. But the other thing is to make sure that you have all the bullets highlighted for each year so they can find them. Here's the graphic that was used during the Power DMS webinar. So this kind of goes into a little more detail than what mine did. So what was presented is the concept of you have a 3-bullet standard. This happens to be constitutional requirements. Was it 1.2.3 or 1.4? Somewhere in there. Bullet A is for interviews, B is for interrogations, and C is access to counsel. Typically what we see on onsites is that an agency will use a case report, an incident report, an arrest report, whatever you want to call it, for interviews and for interrogations. And so they can use a similar document for each year for both bullets. Easy. But typically they'll use like a rights waiver form or Miranda waiver form for bullet C. So you'd use that document for bullet C and not A and B. Does that make sense? Clear as mud? Now, if you do have a document, maybe you do have a written an arrest report for the detective or the investigator, can all 3 of those bullets covered? Use the one report. Done. They have the interview. They start an interrogation. I read so-and-so as Miranda rights. He asked for his attorney. Attorney so-and-so showed up. You highlight all those 3 things, and it's done. You can use the one document. But in this example, they just use the rights waiver. Here's an example of how that looks in Power DMS. So remember, it is very important that you use the best practices in Power DMS to title your documents, making sure you use WD, I didn't do it here, but WD and whatever the document name is, approved to show that it's approved, and then the year, and then the highlights should do appropriately with the bullet number or letter. So what's the impact on you? Like I said, we as staff kind of put the brakes on making a change a year and a half ago, or 2 years ago, to Appendix G, because we knew it was going to have a large impact on all of you. So we think with Power DMS now being part of this, that it'll be a little more easy to make this change. And we're still not asking to go back to where it used to be, where it was three documents per year. Let's still just do one proof per year. And that we thought that it would probably have less of an impact. But as we were talking, or you guys were talking earlier, this issue is creeping up as well. This assessor time allotment. And that has been an issue on a few onsites, especially for those where the assessor has to travel a great distance. Karen Shepherd, our assessment manager, does try to keep the assessors regional to the agency they're going to, rather than sending everyone to the West Coast. She tries to do that, but unfortunately that doesn't always occur. So I know Amy told me she went to California. Well, that's a whole day, I mean, that's your whole 8-hour trip for one day tied up in flights. I mean, you can't even work when you get there. So this is becoming a problem. There's no doubt. How we're going to fix it, I don't know. But I will tell you, where we've seen it become more of a problem is for agencies that are unprepared for their on-site, or they have very unorganized files. And the one that I had within our region, it was during the off-site review, the assessor said, we just cannot get through these files. They got so many irrelevant documents in the file, we can't get through them. And so they stopped the on-site and asked the agency to reschedule for the next cycle. So they gave them an extension and rescheduled it. So what happens there is they have to pay now for the off-site file work that was done in the previous assessment period, and then they'll have to pay for the full job later on. So it will have about an $850 cost, I think, to the agency is what it was. So you want to try to eliminate those issues for yourselves. So the easiest way to do that is to make sure that you are following Appendix G. Use the one document per bullet if you can, and then get the other documents put in to fill in the ones you can't use the one document for. Don't put in irrelevant proofs, and don't put in multiple proofs per year if you can avoid it. There's another option that can happen if the assessors run out of time. The other option is that they continue doing their work. I mean, they've got pay periods just like all of us in our regular jobs, right? So if they come down to where the agency says, we understand it's going to cost us more money, and then CALEA does something to get them more time in a different pay period so they can continue with the on-site assessment.
It just seems, like they should just come up with a fee and figure out how to do it. This nickel and diamond agency is going to wear thin.
Sure.
And, you know, some factors that you can't even take into consideration. What if you just have, like, a slow reader assessor? And, I mean, so that happened to me in Colorado,
right.
The lead assessor didn't get in, but
until
day two.
Exactly. This was never an issue before the first of the year, because assessors were independent contractors. They were paid to do a job, X. They were to do the assessment for agency ABC, and it didn't matter how many hours they did or they worked. They were told to keep regular hours as much as possible, but we all know that didn't happen. I was on sites where we worked from 8 a.m. to 11 at night. Every night, because the agency was so unprepared for the on-site and their files were a mess. But We believe in the process. Assessors are not doing this to get rich. They're doing this because they believe in the FOIA process. And so we worked with the agency and got things fixed and got them accredited. I mean, we got them through the process. But there are, because of now the Virginia Employment Commission's ruling that says no, assessors are part-time employees. And as such, you must follow the Fair Labor Standards Law. So it's just like you and your jobs now. If you're scheduled to work for 40 hours, and you work more than 40 hours, and the boss finds out about it, and you didn't put in for overtime, the boss has to do that for you. They have to pay you for what you work. So somehow we need to figure out how to work around this. I don't know what the answer is. We're gonna have to talk about it, and I know
move the lead to a different.
What's that?
Move the lead to a different state.
That hasn't been talked about. But I don't know if that'll fix the issue. I really don't.
Do you see the impact of the 4-year cycle where files are being reviewed every year, impacting the amount of time for the offsite work, or I mean, actually,
I see that eliminating this issue. So it's going to take a few years for that to happen when everyone's on the 4-year cycle. But by that time, when the on-site assessment team goes to your agency, all the files are reviewed. They won't have to do that. So their time will be less constrained to file work. So yes, you're exactly right. By that time, this will not be a problem. It's just going to be in this interim period where it will be an issue for some agencies. So that's why I recommend to do the best you can with your files and make sure they're concise, they're direct, and don't make them read things you don't want them to see, or don't need them to see, put it that way. Only show them what you want them to see.
And I have to say, this is a general feeling. This is going to come up with people that we get groups of compliance for our agency, because we really push to have quality groups of compliance in our file, and really push to say, we need to show we're following our policies, and to say, thanks for showing me into your job. I just need a rights waiver because I'm only going to put a rights waiver in the file. That really is going to make it difficult for me to sell that this is a good process.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, we may, year one, put a rights waiver in, and year two, I'll throw a video in. Because a rights waiver just says somebody filled out a rights waiver. Throwing a video in says our officer followed our policy for paying that rights waiver. Or various other policies. So we're going to go backwards a little bit, I think, in that just give me the same document every year because that's all that legal wants.
Well, I think
that's unfortunate.
But I think it's also coming on the assessor to take a look at all that stuff to achieve the end. I don't have to do everything that I want.
Exactly.
Right. I would like to have it available to me. If I feel I need more details, I mean, it's easier, and talk the choices between them, it's easier for you to give me, this is race, that's it.
Yeah.
It's easier for you to give me too much and I can point through the stuff, rather than if you don't give me something and I have a few blurry questions, that's time consuming to get back to somebody and say, where's a piece of puzzle? I don't know.
Right, and that's the thing. We are, for our program, we have the staff and we have the money and we have the resources to really have that process. But what we're getting is you use the arrest information form as your group of compliance for every single year, and that is all we want, and that's all we want in the file. But you can throw extra stuff in there, but the assessors don't want to see it, they don't have time to see it.
I understand it's
difficult.
That's why I said you're talking to push the point.
Yeah.
It's terrible time consuming to be an assessor if something just isn't making sense and I have to contact the AM and walk through it and they're trying to get into the document.
Right.
Yeah, the difficult right. part is if something is documented 1 year and not documented another year,
yeah.
And so do I just say, hey, I'm never going to use this as a proof of compliance, even though it's great, because I don't know that I'm going to get 4 years of it.
Right. I don't, and I don't know that you necessarily have to change what you are doing currently, because it's working for you. It's just make sure it's concise. That's all I'm saying. Make sure it's concise. If you're going to use multiple proofs for different bullets, that's great. I mean, that does add more life to that file for the assessment. But do keep it concise. And Ray's exactly right. That's when I was a team leader, that's how I ran my team. I told my team members, this is what we're going to do. We're going to read the file until we're satisfied that they have verified compliance. You don't have to read every document in the file. I never did, ever. I read, if there were three documents for each year, I picked one. And if it worked, I went to the next year. I didn't mess around with looking at all. So I didn't take that kind of time. And I think most people do, but there are some assessors out there, and it usually happens when they're new assessors. They feel compelled to read each and every document that you provide to them because you've taken the time to give it to them. So it must mean that you want them to read it. So they're taking the time to do that. So just know that this issue is out there, and I think Carrie's right. It's going to go away. It's going to go away with the four-year process. But the CSMs are under the same kind of time constraint. I think they have 12 hours, I think, per agency, I think. I think it's like 12 hours they have to do your annual review. That's not a lot of time, but they're getting darn good at it, and they're darn good people. So you know, that's the one thing we did right. We picked very good assessors to become compliance service members. And from what I've heard of that new process, we've had very few problems, very few complaints about how the CSMs have interacted with agencies. And they've been very amenable to changes with the standards list if you weren't ready with a certain standard. And they worked with the agency very well. So I do think this will go away. This will not be a problem that's going to stay around for long. So let's go over some examples. So here's some standards. These are from the sixth edition. That I forgot to tell you. Remember, this change for Appendix G that you had to prove each bullet each year, only applies to sixth edition. So when you move into sixth edition, that's when you need to start doing that. You don't need to change it now if you're under fifth. Keep doing what you're doing. But when you have to change to the sixth edition, that's when this new Appendix G will apply to you. Okay? So let's look at these standards. This is the use of force analysis standard from sixth edition law enforcement. So it's got A through E bullets. How many documents, different documents, do you think it would take to prove compliance with the standard for 1 year?
For one year.
Probably. I mean, if written correctly, a use of force analysis probably would prove all those bullets. Now, if you're using something like IA Pro and to track all your use of force incidents and whoever writes your analysis prints out all of your cases for the year and has a list, that may be a separate document. That if it's not included with your analysis, you may have a separate document for that. But it's included as a reference document within the analysis, and now it's one document. It's done. So that's the only thing I can think of that. How about the command protocol standard, 12.1.2? Four bullets. Different things, you know, command protocol for when the chief is absent, for exceptional circumstances, situations with personnel from different functions in normal day-to-day operations. How many, if you're using a document to prove this, because remember, you can use interviews, you can use other forms, but if you're using a document, how many different documents could you use there? Okay. My former agency probably would be four as well. However, I did think, when I was putting the slide together, we had a document that I probably could have used, one document for all four, if I got the right month, where I was, as chief, I was out of town doing an assessment for some other thing. In fact, it did happen. I was out of town for an assessment. I had my second in command in charge. We had an exceptional situation. So they had barricaded gunmen. Guy tried to kill his girlfriend. My guy shot and killed him when he came out with a samurai sword to attack the officers. So shot and killed him. And so we had different people in different functions during that deal and day-to-day operations. If I could have found that 1 month where all that stuff happened at one time, my senior clerk put together a monthly employee stats to get to HR for our paychecks. And there was a document that listed all that crap. I could have used that one document for all four of those. Now, it wouldn't have said, guy with a samurai sword, you know, that, for that exceptional circumstance, but we could have put a note that said, here's when Lieutenant so-and-so was in charge of the agency, because here's his pay increase when he was acting chief. Could have been something like that. Job announcements. So this is the job announcement standard. You got to provide all these different things in your announcement. How many different proofs per year would you need for them? Probably one if your recruitment notice is drafted properly and has all that stuff in there. If it's not drafted properly, you're out of compliance anyway, right? Because you miss one of those things. How about uniform enforcement procedures, traffic stops type of thing? Directive 4, physical arrest, citations or notice to appear, or for warnings, how many different documents? Okay, that'd be one. Or it could be 3, right, for 3 different cases. Or you got a real aggressive officer and had all 3 of those things happen in one incident. One incident report for all 3. That would work too. Okay. Termination procedures. So when a person is terminated, directive requires written statement for the reason of termination, effective date of termination, a standard or a statement of accrued benefits. How many doctors? 1. Probably. If written properly, that letter probably could do it. In my situation, in my former agency, I'd have to have 2. Because this stuff came from the HR director, this stuff came from the benefits coordinator. So I had 2 different documents that were flowing through there. Now what did I do? I merged the 2 documents in a PDF and put them into 1. Made it 1 document. Right,
that is. That's
just
a note.
Yep.
During this assessment?
Did not occur. Yep. Any questions about that? I'll tell you what we have done as staff. We went through the standards, and I can't remember what the numbers were, and I don't have them with me. Randy Scott went through everything, because Randy was from the Midwest. He was the liaison on the 6th edition manual committee. So he went through the 6th edition, and based on his experience as an assessor and an accredited manager, he gave a number for how many standards he thought there would have to be multiple types of proofs for a standard. And it was a low number compared to the 460 total standards now. It was a pretty low number, but he thought you would have to use a different proof within that standard. So based on that, that's why we moved forward with the change that we saw. So hopefully, you know, combined with the 6th edition, changes that were out there, I know there's some issues with some of the standards, but hopefully with some of the combining of some of those standards and the use of Power DMS, this will have a lesser impact on your day-to-day operations as an accreditation manager trying to comply with the standard. I hope. Any questions on the Appendix G thing? Did it help knowing where we were, or is it just me? Where we came from and where we're going?
Well, it makes us, I think, less angry that it felt like I guess it makes it feel a little bit better that they were admittedly telling us to do things wrong,
yeah,
instead of just changing their mind.
Yeah.
And I
guess I'd like some clarification. Are you saying, like a fan suggested, that so bullet A for all four years has to be the same exact group?
No. Doesn't have to be. Doesn't have to be. I'm just saying.
Why did we think that?
That's really what it sounded like from that lesson.
Okay.
That's what it had to be.
And it's not, it was more of an example of if you use an incident report each year to prove bullet A, B, C, and D, and all those bullets are in each year for that one incident report, then you can do that one per year without a problem. But with the Power DMS option, being able to highlight stuff and connect it, I just do all four of them and be done with it. Just do them all. I mean, we're going to sort them out now with that tool. We can sort out and stuff by the filter so the assessor doesn't have to take as much time. I didn't know about that crap until Laura showed me a couple weeks ago. I had no clue. I saw it. I clicked on it by mistake when I was using it. What did I do? I broke it. But she showed me how to use it a couple weeks ago. So you don't have to use that proof, but just make sure that you cover each bullet appropriately. That's all I'm trying
to say. Curiosity, I'm sure that the answer is going to be yes, you need to do that. So, reporting for advice, narcotics, and organized crime, those within the CPD are three separate bureaus.
Mm-hmm.
In the past, maybe we would approve, let's say, order favor A and B, 1 year for vice, C and D, 1 year for narcotics. Of course, all the directives were there. Are we approving every bullet every year for each of those bureaus for each mission? So vice, narcotics, you've organized crime. So let's say it's just a standard, no more.
Right.
I need to have basically 9 proofs of compliance. Or 3 proofs of compliance every year. 1 for vice, 1 for narcotics, 1 for organized crime. Because they are split up.
Right. Maybe. I mean, that's the only answer I can give you. Cash funds. I've used cash funds. Multiple cash funds.
Special
right.
Purpose vehicles. Right?
Special purpose, same thing.
Yeah.
The way I did my files, let me go back to this example back here. The way I did my files, and this is just how I did it, I titled, and it was like the cash funds, petty cash. And that had A, B, C, and D for each year under petty cash. So I did each one separately. And the next one, confidential funds, you know, each year, A, B, C, D, through it. So I did each one almost like a separate file. That's what I did just to make it easier. Now, did the assessor have to go through each one? No. They can choose what they want to look at.
If you've got like 15 or 20 special purpose vehicles.
Right. Same kind of thing. It's going to be a huge file to show all that. Right. So that's what I did. I mean, again, the assessors don't need to read everything.
I'd rather you say the accreditation folks don't need to prove everything.
I would too. But what's the whole purpose is you're trying to show compliance for all 4 years for each standard. And you can't prove a standard if you don't do all the bullets. So that's the concept, unfortunately.
Under that same thinking, say you had a use report. Do I gotta show a use report for each bureau? I don't think so.
No.
I would think that if you had, like we have 4 different fund accounts, that would be a situation where if you wanted to show compliance all the way through, your first year you could use your petty cash, your second year we could use our narcotics funds, our third year you could use investigative funds to show consistently
right
how you're doing.
I wouldn't have a problem with that. How about the other assessments? I would not have an issue with that. I just did, for cash funds, when I use that example, because where did Chief get in trouble? money, drugs, that's, I always did the money thing to the nth degree. So, just me. Because remember, I was the chief and accreditation manager for a while. So I wanted to make sure it was done right. All right. Any other questions with Appendix G? Yes, ma'am. All right. 4-year process. Here's how I'm doing this one today. These are the questions that I'm asked regularly about the 4-year process. So it's part of how you move into that 4-year process. So let's go through these questions, and then if you have other ones at the end, then let's ask them. We'll make sure everyone's clear. Okay. So an agency has their on-site assessment in the 3-year process. They're ready to move to the new 4-year process after they get their next award. So let's say you just had your on-site in April. You're going to the July conference in Providence, right? When do you get access to Power DMS if you don't currently have it? That's a question I get a lot, because our team members said we should get a jump on this thing right now. So when do I get access to Power DMS? Well, Power DMS is a contract addendum issue for us. When you enrolled with CALEA, or you signed an addendum earlier for the electronic manual in Power DMS. So you signed an agreement, your agency did, to get you access to the electronic manual in Power DMS. Now that we're going to upgrade your subscription to Power DMS to include the assessment module, that has to be a contract type issue for Power DMS and for CALEA, because we're paying for it, so it's going to be like a pass-through from you through us to them, pay for that. So after your on-site assessment, and most likely prior to your conference, Wendy Jones is going to send out a contract addendum email. It'll be an email that goes to you and the CEO. It says click on this link, and it'll create these documents to amend your contract with CALEA. You go through that, you complete that process, you have whomever in your municipality, governmental unit, sign that document, whoever can sign contracts, and then email them back to Wendy Jones. She will then contact Power DMS and tell them that you have that addendum contract signed and to turn your agency on. Now, when that happens, I can't tell you the exact date. Here's what I do know for sure, is that Power DMS will send your login information to you after you receive your award. Well, I have heard some agencies got it before their award. So it might happen early. But for sure, after you receive your award, your next award in July. Why after your next award? Because your 4-year time clock doesn't start until you receive your award and you move into your next cycle. That's when your 4-year start. That's when this whole addendum takes place and becomes effective, is when your next 4-year cycle starts. Okay? So that's why you don't receive it until after. Yes, but my assessor said I should get an early jump on it. Good advice. I would do the same thing. So if you want, you have two options. If you want, you can call Power DMS and request a prorated monthly fee to get early access to the assessment module, and it's about $37.50 a month. So from, let's say, May to July would be, 3 months? So you pay a little over $100 or whatever to get early access for that.
Is this for new agencies that don't have Power DMS?
New agencies or those who do not have Power DMS permit. And we do have quite a few that are out there that are still on paper, working case. If you don't want to do that, I had one agency tell me, it's not in our budget. Not going to happen. I know it's only $100 whatever, but it's not going to happen. It's not in the budget. Well, then my recommendation to you is get ready to prepare your files for when you do receive Power DMS. Get a jump on it this way. Create your directives in MS Word format, because that's what you're going to need to upload them into to Power DMS. So put them into Word format if they're not already, and create a folder on your network, on your PC, wherever, and start saving your scan proofs of compliance ahead of time. So when you do get access to Power DMS through us after your award, you'll have all that stuff in one place. You start putting it into your assessment module, and you'll have a jump anyway. Does that make sense? Any questions on this from this group? I think a lot of you are already on Power DMS, so it's not an issue. No? Okay. All right, what is my accreditation cycle? Well, the accreditation cycle, you would have an on-site assessment in November, let's say, in this example, and you would get your award in March. Or what we're talking now, if you had an on-site in April and your award in July. Okay? Your cycle runs from one award to the next award of that period there. So even though you have all this other stuff going on between it, your accreditation cycle is from award to award. Okay? So it's that period of time then for this agency. What happens if I get an extension? You want a one cycle extension to go to a different conference, or you're not ready, you had a new CEO right before the onsite was supposed to happen, you know, whatever the situation, you want an extension. So what happens then? What happens is we would extend out this last period of time until the next conference. So your onsite would move as well. So rather than being in November in this case, you get moved to the January, February, more like February timeframe. And then your award gets moved out as well. You get presented at that next conference. Now, the tricky part is this. Your award is backdated to whatever your award date used to be. You don't date it on the date you received it. It's dated when it should have been back in March. This also messes up your proof periods, but I don't want to confuse you too bad if this is not an issue for you. Because your proof period starts the last day of the onsite assessment until the next assessment starts. Any questions there with extensions? I don't think we had any this time around. In this group, anyway. Okay. What is my assessment cycle? So we talked about accreditation cycle. What's my assessment cycle? Well, your assessment cycle, like I just mentioned, runs from on-site date, so in this case, November, for a March award, on-site date until your next review, or next on-site. You're still in a three-year process, but none of you are going to be because you're moving to the board. So, this happens next time. It is from your on-site assessment until the start of your annual review, which will be 1 year after your award. Not 1 year after your on-site, 1 year after your award, give or take 30 days, plus or minus. So, it'll be happening in that time period of March, April. Okay? So it just keeps running out like that, from review to review to review, and here to review and on-site. That is technically your assessment cycle, from assessment until assessment. Now, this used to be what your proof period was as well, and technically it still is. That's your proof period. But we recommend, because that is a little more difficult for some people to conceptualize, it's not truly 1 year anymore. It's a year and 3 months, and it's 9 months on the end, or what? It messes people up. So we're teaching it this way now in preparing for the four-year process. Start your proof period at the last day of your on-site assessment and run it for 1 year. Then start your next process, or your next proof period, 1 year after that. It'll be your second year. That gives you, in this case, part of November, December, January, and February to tweak all those files for the annual review coming up in March. So you've collected proofs through this 1 year period, you tweak them for a few months while you're still collecting your two proofs starting in November. So it's year two, year three, year four. So it's then a 1 year calendar type situation rather than 14 months, 15 months, and then shorter at the end. So start your proof periods at the end of your on-site assessment, make them for 1 year, and move it through. With a caveat, let's say you collected your proofs through here, and you did not have any use of lethal force situations for that year. But oops, in January you did. What should you do? Do you save it and not include it for the annual review the first time? You just put in that year two proofs and not provide it? I would provide it, because technically that is the assessment period, remember, until the next assessment. So I would provide something that did not occur in that 1 year proof period. If it occurred before your review, proof it out and provide it for them in that first review. Does that make sense? Good point. And I would not use 2015, 2016, 2017 anymore myself. I would use year one, year two, year three, year four. Get away from the calendar year number because it'll mess you up. Just me. Because that does come a question. Well, do I provide 2016 proofs for this first year? Well, technically, yes. I mean, that's when they're valid. You don't have to provide them in 2016 if you've got one later on. But that's when the proof is valid, is within that 1 year period. Any questions? Good. All right. When will I know about my first web-based review? Well, we've already talked about the fact that it happens 1 year after your award date, give or take 30 days. Your award date, give or take 30 days. How this process will all work, though, is you will receive a series of emails about 8 to 12 weeks prior to that time. The first one will be to you and the CEO, and it's basically information. Dear Chief, your annual review is coming up in a few months. This is what it's all about. That's pretty much all it says. Shortly thereafter, you receive the second one. And the second email comes in saying, here's who your assigned compliance service member will be, and this is the week in which they will conduct your annual review. And it can be any time, like I said, 30 days, give or take, of your annual or your award date. You will also receive an email giving you access to the CALEA Information Management and Reporting System, SIMRS. And we talked about that a little earlier today as well. The biggest issue we're having with this part of the process is that SIMRS email notification is coming from a Gmail address. And unfortunately, a lot of IT departments are blocking Gmail addresses. So when it's about 8 to 12 weeks out for your first review, start looking at your junk mail, because it could go there. I don't know how you can, what is it called? Is it called whitelisting? Is that what it's called for an email? Whitelisting email address? I don't know how to approve that so it doesn't get blocked. But that's usually what happens. Somebody calls me and says, hey, my first review is up in a month and I haven't got anything yet. Check your junk mail. And they find it. But if you do have that situation, let me know and I'll have Christy Goddard resend that email as well, and hopefully we can avoid that issue for you. So you'll get that email as well saying, here's your password and admin login for the SIMRS program. You will also then get an introductory phone call from the CSM about 6 to 8 weeks prior to the scheduled annual review. For introductions, and they will then provide you a list of those standards that they're going to look at. No, it's not set. It's all individualized. How this list is derived? First, guaranteed all-time sensitive standards. Guaranteed. So just know that's going to be there. Second, any issues on your final report, any standards issues, future review issues identified in your final report will be on that first year as well. Okay? After that, then it's going to be any issues that are identified in previous annual reviews will be on the following review as well. The third thing we look at, that Christy looks at when developing this list, is your annual reports that you send to me. So if you list in that document that you had changes to your use of force policy, your use of force standards will be included in that review. So just a point of reference then, don't list those standards for changes just because you changed someone's name in or a typographical error that you corrected. So if you're using just Power DMS report that says here's all the stuff that was put out during the year, go through and strike out the ones that were just grammatical or not substantive change. Highlight the ones that were a major change, and we'll upload it that way. That way she doesn't look at the stuff that was just grammatical. Okay? So that's how that list is derived. So you'll have several weeks to be able to tweak those standards, make sure all the bullets are covered, and then if you have all the proofs in order. But if you have something where it has not occurred, you have an issue where it has not occurred, go ahead and tell the CSM that. That file's not ready yet because that did not occur. And they'll pick another standard somewhere. Or if you tell them that standard is NA for us, they'll pick another standard. So there's some give and take in that process. Make sure you start inputting your statistical information into centers. From what I've been told, I do not have access to CIMRS, so I can't see any of your stuff. I can't log into a system and help you with it. We have no work, like a play site or anything for that, so I can't show you how it works. I think in the last meeting that I presented this stuff, it was just screenshots for you. That's the best I can do. But from what I've been told from people who have now used it, it's very simple. Everyone's getting all worried about this for nothing. It's a simple program. It's just to track your stuff. It's no big deal. So enter your stats in there. Enter the information it's looking for. And I suggest you use for some of that what was put in your last final report. Because you need to put in CEO bio, community description, that kind of stuff is all in your last report. Just copy and paste it and put it in there for the next time around, or change if you want to change it. One issue that came up yesterday at the Indiana PAC that I didn't know about, so I'll tell you, is you go through your first year, what will happen is, so you just had to review what will happen. The CSM will put all their notes into CIMRS, and they crank out a report. When that report is completed, the CEO will receive an email saying, you can now provide feedback on your annual report, your annual review. So make sure that you're keyed into that as well, and you can help your CEO with any of the issues within that report. And then the report will be finalized and locked at that point, and then no changes will be made to that report at all. Now, I didn't know is when they lock that report, it locks you out of the CIMRS program. So you can't go in and make next year's changes right away. So we worked around it last night. I talked to Travis Parrish last night, and we worked around it for an agency. It's just a way that you have to open up your next year's review. I guess it's just a couple clicks or something to open up your next year review, and you can get access to that next stuff. So if you're trying to get prepared ahead of time,
yeah,
let me know and I'll see if we can get it opened up. I guess
why can't we have it for every year that we're in? Like, I would love just to put my agency bio and everything in now.
And
at the
keep
beginning.
Track of it.
Yeah.
Yep. So that's what I said.
I don't like this wait and then hurry up to get it all done. I would love it if you could make that happen.
He's trying to make it so it's automatic. So once it's closed, the next year open.
Or even like now that I'm into it, the first year, I have it open now.
Right. So anyway, so that we are working through that, and he's trying to fix that as well. But it's So initially, you may be locked out of it. Let me know if you want to get access early so that you can update the file for the next time and get a jump on it. Back to this slide real quick. HC status reports, currently, they still come to me. So when you complete that, send them to me. They are due on your award anniversary date. So email it to me, and then there's a place within Simmers to upload that document after you send it to me. So you send another copy into Simmers so that the CSM has access to it. I don't have access to Simmers. They don't have access to our accreditation management system. So it kind of goes both ways. So that's where I put your stuff, is into the accreditation management system. Yes?
So the stats in the Simmers, do we still do the Excel tables? Or we don't do those anymore?
Nope, they're all those tables are in Simmers, and you do them on an annual basis, so you don't have to do all three at one time.
Yeah, because the agents and status report, we still get the one that's on the website.
Currently, and send it to me. Phase two of Simmers is to get this report built into Simmers so that you don't have to send it to me and upload it. So you'll be able to create the document in Simmers and it's put wherever it needs to be put. We're working on that. We had discussions on that this week. There's two of us that are assigned to help with that part of the process. So that's started. Hopefully we can get that to happen. Phase three is to connect, my understanding anyway, connect Power DMS with Simmers as far as some of this reporting, stuff that's going back and forth. Because the CSMs and the assessors have to work in both programs at the same time. They have to make some notation in Power DMS what they found, if it's in compliance or in progress or whatever, then they also have to put in Simmers that it was verified or not verified. So they're doing duplicate work as well. So hopefully we can get those two folks, Power DMS and Simmers, talking to each other. All right. So after you've got your first web-based review out of the way, we talked about that report. Just like on an on-site assessment, your CSM is going to give you suggestions, recommendations, that are not noted in the report, right? Happens all the time. I'm not gonna note this time, but you might wanna fix this. Make those adjustments because they're giving you their best opinion as far as how to get through this process in the future. How many have done their first review? Okay, a couple of you. Did the process go what I'm telling you now? Was it pretty simple?
My only first thing was the I didn't know that they would have access to all my files. I was trying to go in Power DMS and just highlighting the ones that they had given me, but it wouldn't allow me to. And then I was told, and I didn't care if they wanted to look at anything else, or whatever they may have needed to do, but if they did, they never, you know, told me that they wanted to look at anything else.
Right.
I was pretty well off with it, and it didn't matter. But just know that you opened it.
Open
every standard that is to them, and that they just pick the ones that they need.
Right.
And then report the end of the project, and they
merge
the
get access to
it? I got in right away, and like all my bio stuff and all that stuff is carried over in my year two.
Maybe.
The only thing I have like a what is that, an I or a T or whatever that little thought is that I can put on for like my successors. You know, things that have happened in the past year.
Right.
But all my other stuff, my agency stuff, all that stuff that's new, things that I do. So I guess if I get in the studio or something like that, I'll
right. Same experience?
Yeah, the only thing that seemed to be a snag was the similar. I never did get the email and the memo on my dad and all that stuff.
Wow.
The assessor didn't seem to think that was
a problem. Yeah, they're working around all that stuff. I mean, what I've been told, and don't shoot the messenger, what I've been told is all the bugs in Simmers have now been fixed. So I know there was some issues with some agencies getting connected, but I've been told it is now fixed. And that's why they're moving on to phase two, which is to create more stuff. We'll probably break it again, but we'll try.
Just say, well, this doesn't have anything to do with that. I'm just curious, why in power the analysis of the numbers and the analysis, why can't I go and look at the Simmers, even though I'm still in the model?
You can't. When you're in your assessment, when you're in the assessment module, you do not want to click update.
What you can do is you can open up a new assessment for
access the manual through the standards manual portion, not
you're
in
so
the
assessment. Smart hands on.
The problem with that you have to go into the manual part, if you go there now, you will see 6th edition because it is the most recent version of the manual. So now you'll have the problem is, well, how do I get back to 5.23? That's what we're in. So I think that's, I think
but
I sent
I
out an email
like
a couple weeks ago. If it will let you.
You can have them two assessments up at the same time on two different
sites.
Yeah,
you might be in my box.
Yeah, and copy those. So you can open a new one in that version. Like right now, we're working in 6. But I still have my other one that I can see, and I can have it over at the same time.
I should have done that. I put the same. This assessment on the right here.
If you're going to stay in 5.23 for now, do not click that upgrade version because it will move everything over. Now it's going to tell you 4 times. Are you really sure you want to upgrade? But I've had people go through all 4 of those and then get to the end and go, I can't go back. Well, you're right. You just converted everything. So there was a lot of work to get it back to status quo, but we were able to do it. But yeah, don't upgrade that assessment if you're not ready for it. Yep. All right. Conference reminders real quick. Well, before that, moving into the four-year process, are there any other questions that I didn't answer through this? Question answer. How about converting into the 6th edition? Any questions there? You don't have to convert until after your next award. Even the people who were accredited in March have now 4 years until they have to do it. No? Okay. Conference reminders. Here's the conferences for the rest of this year. Providence and Jacksonville in November.